My name is Rita Keegan. I was born in New York. From my earliest age, when you asked me what I wanted to be, I used to say, I want to be an artist. God knows why. I went to art and design. My last 2 years, I specialized in fashion illustration and costume design. But I also then met lots of other strange little arty kids. And we were in Midtown Manhattan, which was wonderful, two blocks away from Warhol's studio, around the corner from Bloomingdale's, and would just, you know, Manhattan just became my playground. You know, the 60s and 70s in the Bay Area with the Black Panthers and political awareness, anti-war. So you didn't live outside of world events. World events were around you. I've had the luck, or not lack of luck, to live in interesting places at interesting times, and to do more than just witness history, but be part of it. I moved to Brixton and got involved in the Brixton Art Gallery, which I guess was probably my first real experience of curatorship. In college, even though I've always been around the arts and even though I've always gone to museums, you weren't taught about how to show your work or showing your work or how to hang it or the lighting. That was somebody else's job. That was, you know, the great art critic from the sky was supposed to discover you, or and then your work was going to be taken away and shown. And it, so that whole means of process was not in the hands of the maker. And I guess that goes in with the whole myth of the artist, whether it's a singer, a dancer, that's supposed to be a Svengali, or someone that shows you to the world. And Brixton Art Gallery, it was full of a wide range of people, a wide range of ages. And it was, I quite often say, it's sort of, my dad has a barn, let's put on a show. And that was basically it. We had a gallery, let's hang some work. And we foolishly did a show a month. I don't know what encouraged people to think that they could actually do a show a month, but we did. So that's like a 3-week show in a week, getting stuff out and putting stuff in. But it was a baptism of fire. We shared practice and we shared process, not just practice. And the woman's art show was very much one where I guess we tapped into the traditional ways that women worked. Textile pieces where people handed in a square, or when we did a catalog, everybody did a page. Every page is different. All it had to be was an A4. I guess that sort of started my role in documenting, because also in the reality of feminist practice, that one learned from the suffragettes, that if you didn't document yourself, you weren't going to get documented. And I think because you had the revisiting of the suffragettes and their practice, you realized that no one was also going to collect your stuff. That you were, if you didn't keep on top of it, you were going to get written out of history. And that held true also with artists of color. It was very important to document what we did, if only to be able to pass around the documentation.
How do you remember RKAP starting, so the Rita Keegan Archive Project?
I was doing this project that the government sponsored, was to go to the gym. So I was pumping iron, and this woman came up to me. I vaguely recognized her, and it was Gina. And we went for probably a really fattening latte or chai or something afterwards. And she said, Do you remember working on this project at the Women's Library? And I'm thinking, Women's Library, working on a project. And then I realized that she was talking about the Women's Slide Library, and the project was 1990, and it was the Women of Color Index. And it was incredibly difficult for me to even remember it, because so much of the work we do as freelancers, you do the work, you try not to be hysterical because you didn't get paid enough or whatever, however you left, or you moved on to the next thing. And so you don't necessarily, you kind of remember it. And so you have to remember it. So I said, yeah. And she said, well, I'm working with this group, and we're at, Studio Voltaire, and we're a group called X Marks the Spot, and we're working with Althea Greenham at Goldsmiths. And I said, oh, Althea, love her. So she said, well, would you like to come and meet us? And I thought, yeah, okay, let's, you know. But I had to really dig deep into the memory to remember that I did that, because I think by that time it was 20 years ago or more. And as I said, you know, you get on with your life if you can. Yeah. Now, I'm dyslexic, so the idea of actually being a librarian is, you know, I know my alphabet. That's as far as it goes. But I was aware that it needed to, how I was going to archive it. So I asked a very good friend of mine, Liz Ward, who used to be at Chelsea. She was a librarian at Chelsea. And she said, just do it the simplest way, you know. And I said, well, I've been doing it, you know, alphabetically. And she said, fine, that's the best way to do it. You don't need subtext. You don't have to do Dewey Decimal. You just, you know, make it very easy to access. And also, I felt that the archive wasn't about me. It was about the different people. It wasn't about whether I liked work or not. It was that the work was there. It needed to be archived. It needed to be available. So when you all showed up and said, though, you've gone through this stuff and it was really great and you were able to do this and that, I thought, my God, it worked. I actually did what I had wanted to do. And I just was really taken aback that you were able to find out information and information that it was 20 years and nothing had been done with that archive since I did it. And I understood why, because there wasn't a person to take it on, because the library itself had problems with funding. It had to move. It was at Fulham Palace. Fulham Palace moved from Labour to Conservative, so they had no grant. And so and due to Althea's tenaciousness, it did survive and ultimately got the space at Goldsmiths. And I was just delighted that it found a place also within an institution, because the library was great, but the problem that it didn't have all those other books, that it remained outside of the canon of art. And that once it was inside the library, it had the entire university art library to be part of. So it wasn't just this obscure sect. And I think, but also over the last 20, 30 years, I've watched all these art organizations and just disappear.
Yeah.
That didn't have funding or, you know, or relied on one individual. The different caps on government and city and state, they have changed the whole, just in my gallery sector.
Yeah.
I hate to think what it's done, you know. I know what it's done across the board. Although that could go there. What do you think? Gina, what's it been like working on this project?
It's been tricky at times. It's been wonderful at times. I mean, we had an incredible session this morning as well.
Yeah.
You know, new people that we're being introduced to, that have been supporting us on the project, stimulating us as a group and individually as well. That's been quite an incredible experience.
What are the collective practices now within RKAP? What ways are collective practices important to you?
I guess with my experience in both the 198 and Brixton Gallery is about the artist's responsibility, and that you do not, as a practitioner, you don't work in isolation, and that it needs to be inclusive as opposed to exclusive. It's, you know, it all sort of sounds like jargon, but it's not the artist working away alone in their studio, because I don't think that, you know, that's ever been a real model. I think that's a Victorian fantasy. We're now doing something constructive because we've been on the phone to the bank for the last hour and a half trying to sort out issues, not of our making. And I want to do off with their heads.
What's it been like trying to work in a sort of current situation?
Well, I think the whole issue is that what I've actually, I mean, it's been difficult, but it has worked out because it actually meant that I had the proper time to work on an exhibition. Uh-huh. You generally have to work on an exhibition, you know, really quickly. You're not given any space. But what the pandemic has done, it's given us an extra year for good or ill. And it meant that we've actually had 2 years to work on the book and the exhibition. Mm. And so that's actually worked well for us. When setting up the archive, I didn't, It is about me, but like my book, it's not about me. So it's about the collection of images. There's a website. Also, hopefully it'll have a life of its own and be able to continue through the people who are involved. It's more ours than mine, and there is space for other people to be involved and other people to be part of it. Because one of the things we're also going to put in the archive are the contributions from the social fabric.
Oh, wow.
That is beautiful.
I'm really gonna have to up my game. We're doing a collective piece. So they'll all have a page in the archive. They'll have an image, but you'll be able to then go to their website, so it ends up being inclusive as opposed to, again, exclusive. It was very interesting when Ego and I were talking about the archive. We'll put together the archive, but then, you know, maybe what we need to do is do some talks, or you could show some of the work, and then you could do a book, and then, you know, and it just got bigger and bigger.
Is it from?
Oh, this is really bizarre. Wow. It smells like ink. It's really lovely. I like the paper. These pieces of paper will ultimately be at Goldsmiths, but not all of it, you know. But I was really happy with the way that that worked and that it managed to capture that 20 years. Because it does kind of go up to 2000 and a little, maybe a little bit past, but the whole thing is that it's not that practice changed because I was always doing digital work, but ephemera changed. Now when they do exhibitions, you don't even get, you may get invited to the private view, but it's on your phone. You don't get that card. You don't get that piece of paper. I was recently invited to participate in the RA summer show. You know, it had the logo and the stamps and the things on it, but it was an email. You know, I didn't get the piece of paper through the, you know, with the little gold crest. If I archive the show, I will archive it'll have to be a digital archive unless I want to print out everything I have. And that's a very different process. And the whole discussions that are had through email aren't necessarily kept. So even this process of having this film from Paul Goodwin commissioning it, there is a digital record, but there is not a paper record.
True.
And if you lose the server, or if the server goes down, or if it doesn't recognize the algorithms, it's gone. Mm. And maybe that's good, but it's different. It's different from the pieces of paper.
And in terms of with this exhibition happening within the next month or so, with the publication, with the invite from the RA, all of that and more invitations to come, how do you see things panning out in terms of curating exhibitions?
I'm a bit overwhelmed.
And future viewers as well.
For the first time, I've actually had support. Mm-hmm. I've always had to do things completely on my own.
Mm-hmm.
And and the fact that I've had a team behind me has just been exceptional.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess my biggest fear is that when the project is over, I'll lose you all, you know. And I guess for the most part, I never like to count on something that I didn't have.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not necessarily fiercely independent, but, you know, there's a certain level where you don't have a choice.
Mm-hmm.
And I quite like that.
Oh, wow. Ooh.